to our Good News program. We're so thankful that you've tuned in. Now, I know that you have been following along with us about the prescription for revival. This must be done, and I want you to listen to these words, and I want each of us to obey them, to see what God can do in the lives of those that are wholly committed unto Him. First, he says, now remember, this is Dr. Torrey. He is a well-known Bible teacher in the late 1800s and 1900s, and his son was Reuben Torrey. He was a missionary in Korea. So he is giving us this prescription. The Lord put this into my hands at the very right time, because the world is so corrupt and evil. We must seek the only help that any person can find is through our Lord Jesus Christ. There is no other way but through Him. We are going to learn a lot. The reason I am going through how to be born again and the truths concerning Christ and the body of believers is so many people have so many questions. And I have asked the Spirit of God to reveal these truths so you will not be confused that you are truly a child of God and has a heavenly Father. Every true child of God is a son of God through faith in Jesus Christ. And this has been the greatest mystery for people that do not know what is going on, because it is the Word of God that reveals these truths to us. Because God's Word, now this is a heavenly divine message. This is a heavenly divine message. So I want you to memorize these two Bible verses. And the first one I want, actually three, in John 17:3. This is life eternal, that they may know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. Now this was his high priestly prayer before he went to the cross. And who was he praying for? For every true believer throughout all generations. This is what we are to know. And then in 2 Corinthians 13:8. Now you know that I have lived by faith all these years. It's the most important thing in life is to know God's Word. I want you to live this same abundant life. I want you to memorize these verses. 2 Corinthians 13:8. For we can do nothing against the truth. It is the Word of God. There's no controversy. We're going to see that today. But for the truth. Now listen, 2 Corinthians 13:8. For we can do nothing against the truth. If we appropriate His truth by faith, every promise will be fulfilled. They are exceeding great and precious promises. It's not our will, but His will. So His word cannot fail, His truth. That's the only living book in the world, and it is the truth. And then Proverbs 21:30. Now just think about these two Bible verses, and you can understand how great our Heavenly Father is. And to love us so much, He would send His only begotten Son into this world to die for the sins of the whole world. And then you become a rich person. You are reigning in life as a king. You are an ambassador for Him. You are a saint of God. And think of being a son of God. Think of someone that great and loves us that much. We must know these verses. Proverbs 20:31. There is no wisdom, nor understanding, nor counsel against the Lord. We must do this prescription for revival and believe every word. There is no other way. And this is the greatest gift for you, because then you will see the blessings of God when you obey Him and know His Word. Meditate on His Word day and night, and to do all that He has commanded you. Then He will make thy way prosperous, and then you shall have good success. That's why these Bible verses are so important. So we see in the beginning, God, He's always been, created the heaven and the earth. The superiority of the faith way. Hebrews 11, 1 through 40, that is the chapter 11 of Hebrews, is the people that lived by faith. And I want you to read that. There's not one sin mentioned against them. Their faith is why they are in the hall of fame. Hebrews 11. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. Is being sure of what we hope for. Now remember His Word, we just read it. We just memorized those two verses. Being sure of what we hope for and certain of what we do not see. 11:3. Through faith, Hebrews 11:3. Through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the Word of God. Psalm 33:6. By the Word, Jesus Christ is the living Word, that is the shining light of the glory of Christ. We must read this every day and study it every day. For by the Word, Jesus Christ, of the Lord God, were the heavens made, and all the host of them by the breath of His mouth. We see Jesus, we see God, we see the Holy Spirit, Trinity. His praise as the Creator. Creation account is in Genesis 1 through 2, chapter 2, verse 3. Begins and leaves no doubt that it is God's revelation of His creation. No human being knew anything about the origin of the heavens and the earth. Man, unable by searching to solve the mystery of creation. Man cannot by searching find out God, nor can man discover how the earth was created and all things came into existence. There is no such thing as evolution. It's all about God and His Son and the Holy Spirit. The scriptures were given not to tell us how the heavens go, but to teach us how to go to heaven. There's only one way, that is through the blood of Jesus Christ. And we're going to find that out in these lessons today. And I want every one of you to ask the Lord to prepare your heart, to prepare your heart to behold wondrous things out of His Word. Let's pray. Oh, our gracious and dear Heavenly Father, we're thankful that we can call Thee Father through faith in Jesus Christ and the cleansing power of the blood. It's not his will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Thou hast given us these lessons to go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature, the good news of Christ dying on the cross, being raised from the dead after 3 days and three nights, and is seated today at the right hand of our Heavenly Father's throne, the throne of grace. That's how we can come today into the holiest by the blood, to obtain mercy and to find grace to help in time of need, and to know that we have a great high priest in heaven praying night and day for each of us. And he is merciful and faithful, and he's touched with our infirmities. Christ in the Old Testament was the prophet to come. Now Jesus Christ, during this dispensation, is our great high priest. And we are going to be reigning as kings and priests, already reigning with all of his infinite resources in heaven. We come with a true heart and full assurance of faith that every word that we speak, that we speak with faith, that we know they will be fulfilled. We know this by the word of God and the truth concerning Christ and our salvation. The greatest news in the world is the gospel. That is good news, that Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, and that he was buried and rose again the third day according to the scriptures. We have prayed for 100-fold all these years, and now is the time for each one of them to understand the truth concerning salvation, our redemption. And we are rejoicing today in 100-fold. May each one accept this gift, believe in the Holy Spirit and his divine teacher, as our divine teacher, to teach us through the word of God all things. In Christ's name we pray, amen. So before you can understand what it is, let a few Christians get thoroughly right with God. If this is not done, the rest will come to nothing. Now, this is what's happening in the last days. Satan is trying to defeat the very elect. If you are obeying Satan, your final abode is the lake of fire. You are obeying your enemy. If you obey these truths, God has a place prepared for you, heaven, that eye hath not seen nor ear heard the glories he has for us. I want every child in the world to hear this message. That's why I'm here for you. God loves you, and I love you. I don't do this for money. I do it for the glory of God and for your salvation, for your obedience and blessings to God. That can only come through the Word of God. So we see we will come to nothing unless we obey this prescription for revival. Let them bind themselves together to pray for revival until God opens the windows of heaven and comes down. You know, he's promised to open the windows of heaven and for each of us that obey his word. I will open the windows of heaven and pour out blessings you don't know how to receive. I know that abundant life. I want you to know it also. And then let us put themselves at the disposal of God for his use as he sees fit in winning others to Christ. Why am I here? For you to know Christ. And then, listen at this. This is all. I have given this prescription around the world. And that's what we're praying for. around the world, every person in the world will hear this. And in no instance has it failed. It cannot fail. Remember our Bible verses? There is no wisdom, nor understanding, nor counsel against this truth. This is God's truth. This is the Lord. And then this is the most amazing thing, for we can do nothing against this truth. All of this will come to pass. So here we have, let a few Christians get thoroughly right with God. But let's face it, this is what we are so reluctant to do. Now we have to obey this. We cannot disobey, but you have to know Christ first. So getting right with God means not only being sure of our salvation as forgiven sinners, but being sure of our fellowship with God, our fellowship with Him, as friends and saints. Abraham was a friend of God. Abraham, are we a friend of God? This is what it means to never retain a grudge against anyone. Never retain a grudge against anyone. Now, nobody has ever been beaten and put on the cross with the nail prints in his hands that he died for us. He died instead of us. And here he is. He died. And when he looked down from the cross, he was rejected. He looked down from the cross and said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. So it means never to retain a grudge against anyone. It means always speaking the truth, experiencing even righteous indignation without giving way to anger or allowing Satan any advantage over us when we are angry. Now, there is a righteous anger. That is, love never tolerates evil. It means never taking property of others, including theft of their good name, by repetition of gossip. God hates gossip. This is one of the things you have to ask God to take this away from us, every person. You're never to speak of anyone's sin. You are to pray for them. That's why I told you in the book of Hebrews chapter 11, their sins are not mentioned. They are there because of faith in God. We're never to talk about another person's sin. It means to use our power of speech to edify and not corrupt. Two things right there about our tongue. It means that we do not grieve God's indwelling spirit by bitterness. You cannot have bitterness. Wrath, anger. You cannot be angry. Be slow to anger and sin not. Clamor, evil speaking, or malice. There's three things: evil speaking, gossip, and not having our conversation corrupt. These are the greatest blessings, and God will do this for us if we obey Him. And it means kindness toward others with tenderness of heart, forgiving and forgiving and forgiving again. As God for Christ's sake hath forgiven us. How many times does He tell us to forgive? 70 times 7. Now, I have been studying this and reading it almost every day. Every day we are to live this. It cannot be just one day. It has to be continually for this to work. Getting right, thoroughly right with God, demands ruthless examination of ourselves and honest confession of sin, both to God and to any person sinned against. Only then will our heart condemn us not. Only then will we have confidence toward God. Only then will we know that whatsoever we ask, we receive of Him, because we keep His commandments and do those things that are pleasing in His sight. That is 1 John 3:21 and 22. But as He which hath called you is holy, so be ye holy in all matter of conversation, because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. This is a prescription for revival. And then you must read chapter 12 and 13 of Romans every day. This is the most amazing story for us as believers, and it has never been done with believers. This is the time that we must do this, because Satan is trying to destroy believers today. He's trying to destroy the home. This is the most amazing time for us to live, to give out God's word, because there's nothing left for us. If He comes soon, we'll be leaving everything behind that we've worked for. If we don't change, He'll be coming soon in the clouds to take believers out of here. Believers are going to be raptured. That is the next thing for true believers. Then the book of Revelation, the Antichrist is going to be there. He's going to be there. The most amazing thing in the world is to think about what he is doing today, trying to destroy every little child by disobedience. Every child. He is deceiving our little children today. We must understand that Romans 5, 1 through 11, the glorious results of justification by faith, the peace with God that passes all understanding, a standing in God's marvelous grace. That's why we come to the throne of grace. If you're not born again, you can't even pray, because the spiritual faculties of the Spirit is faith, hope, reverence, prayer, and worship. You can't even worship. You can't even pray without being born again by the Spirit. And I have had so many people say, what do you mean by being born again? That's why I'm giving you these lessons. Because you must be born by the Spirit of God. It's just like Mary. Just like Mary. She conceived Christ by the Holy Spirit that came into her womb. We receive the new birth by the Holy Spirit coming to dwell in our bodies, because you do not have a spirit without being born again. We have a body, a soul, but our spirit has to be born again, because that is a death chamber after Adam sinned. So we're going to learn about Adam's sin. And when you receive that, then that death chamber, you're dead in trespasses and sin. So you have to understand this. You have eternal life through the Holy Spirit, and He can't work apart from the Word of God. That's why I'm giving you these truths with the Word of God. So we see this sure hope of this coming glory, Him coming in the clouds to take us home, and present patience waiting, and then joy in God. Romans 5, 12 through 9, the two representation of men, Adam and Christ, contrast. Condemnation and death by Adam, all in Adam die. Justification and life by Christ, to all in Him life. This is the difference, and we must understand that these truths that we are giving to you are going to be manifested to all those people around us that need Christ. All of these. So where is Satan today? He is today trying to deceive the very elect. and his final abode is the lake of fire. Why did the devils protest? Because they recognized Jesus Christ when he was on the earth in Matthew 8:29. When then the Lord Jesus Christ demonstrated his messianic ministry, he met two men who were possessed with the devil. It is important to understand that when Jesus is there, truth and light are revealed. Thus, darkness is exposed immediately in his presence. Jesus did not have to identify himself to the devils. The devils exposed themselves when they cried out, saying, "What have we to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of God?" Even the devils know he's the Son of God. Even the devils know that their time is short. "Art thou come hither to torment us before the time?" This is the devils talking to Christ. What did the devils protest? Because they recognized him as the Son of God, the Savior of the world. Thus, the devils knew that Jesus would come and destroy the works of the power of darkness, Hebrews 2:14. They were aware that ultimately they would end up in the bottomless pit. They also knew that the time had not yet come. When Jesus Christ returns in power and great glory to earth and his feet stands on the Mount of Olives, Satan will be arrested and placed in confinement to the bottomless pit. Revelation 20:1-3. This is why we as believers must understand how powerful Satan is, because he's trying to destroy us today.
Somewhere up to the door.